Hello and welcome to the third part of my video series about this expert DataExpert EXP4349 mainboard. The exciting thing about this board is that it supports 386 and 486 CPUs in combination with VLB. As I got this board, it was prepared only for 486 usage and missed all the parts which are required to set up a 386 CPU and a coprocessor. In the first part, I added the missing CPU and FPU sockets, replaced the broken memory slots and added some missing jumpers which were needed for the 386. In the second part, I fought some serious stability issues and was surprised by a very fast performance of this Ali M1429 chipset-based mainboard. Not only it delivered outstanding memory and cache throughput, it reached 26 FPS in Doom with only a 486 DX280 CPU on an ISA card. With 386DX, it didn't show any mind-blowing results, though it was running with VLB graphics card and showed some benefit using its bandwidth. So it is already quite amazing that you can use a 386 and 486 on the same mainboard. But in this video, I would like to go one step further and make this board even more exciting. Later 486 CPUs like DX4100 or even some of the later DX2 variants were released as so-called 3V versions. Well, actually they required 3.3V, but the main difference to the previous versions was that those were designed for 5V power supply. Despite that a DX4100 would theoretically work in the older mainboards, which provided only 5V CPU power supply, it would run very hot and most probably die sooner or later. Therefore, so-called overdrive CPUs existed, which could be used as an upgrade for a mainboard, which lacked 3V CPU support. Such overdrives had an integrated voltage regulator, which converted the voltage down to 3V. We could use such an overdrive CPU in this mainboard, and one long-time viewer of my channel and also a member of the DOS Reloaded DE community, known under the nickname I440BX, borrowed these two beauties to me for some experiments. But such overdrive CPUs were very expensive back then, and they are still rare and expensive today. Another option would be to use a modern times adapter named 486 Socket Blaster, which was made by Scrap Computing. Watch his video and GitHub repository if you are interested. He was so great to release everything as open source. Luckily, we don't have to rely on extra adapters or overdrive CPUs. The real 3V CPU support was introduced on very late 486 mainboards as first Intel Pentiums were already installed in the high-end systems. This board was made around 1994 and is such a late product. It provides multiple solder points for a variety of voltage regulators and also some jumpers to switch between 5V and 3V CPU power supply. So all we have to do is to add an appropriate voltage regulator. I already had a couple of videos where I explained the differences between linear and switching voltage regulators. Since the linear regulators tend to get hot, I would like to use a switching voltage regulator today. Luckily, a 486 doesn't pull that much current, and so we can use something off the shelf. On the all-known online selling platforms, you can find such regulators. All you have to keep in mind when buying those, you need something what delivers 3.3V on the output, and it has to stand 1.5 to 1.8 amps of current. These regulators cost next to nothing, and I have a bag full of them for various projects. They have adjustable output voltage, and I showed one already in one of my videos as a fan speed control. It can stand up to 3 amps in peak and up to 2 amps in long time load, so it is a perfect candidate for our 486 upgrade. This regulator circuit has two inputs, ground and input voltage, and two outputs, again ground and output voltage. Ground on the output and the input are actually connected, so this module has actually three poles, input voltage, output voltage and ground. The module has no pins, which I could use to connect it to the mainboard, so I have to add them. Therefore, I will use some copper wires. One wire goes to the two ground pads. Another wire goes to the input pad, and the third wire goes to the output pad. So, I freed some solder holes already. Let's see where they are going. This is 5 volts. This will go into the voltage regulator. This is ground. This is nothing what we need. Probably a regulator control pin for a linear regulator. This jumper is what redirects the voltage from the regulator to the CPU, so the output of the regulator has to go to this jumper. Okay, this is output, and this is output as well. I will need one of those output solder holes. So, now where I know that the output pin goes in between of the input and ground, I can also solder the red output voltage wire in place. Okay, not super nice, but it should do the trick. By the way, I moved the ceramic capacitor, which I added in the last video, to another place, where it sits a little bit better and closer to the CPU. So here we go, this is how it looks like. All we have to do now is to adjust the CPU voltage. Therefore, I should of course remove all the CPUs. In the last video I mentioned that I replaced the black jumpers by the blue ones. Now you know why. This way I can easily distinguish CPU settings jumpers from the voltage settings. Let's set the jumpers accordingly and tell the mainboard to use the voltage regulator. I will use some wires in the CPU sockets where I will connect the multimeter to measure the voltage. Okay, and we have 4.4 volts. Let's adjust the output to set it as close as possible at 3.3 volts. The variable resistor is super sensitive, but eventually I could set up 3.3 volts. Now let's connect the oscilloscope and see what we get in regards of voltage ripple. We have under 50 millivolts without a load. This should be in limits. Now time to make a real deal. Let's use a 3V AMD 486DX266 CPU first. And we are getting perfect 3.3 volts. Ripple under load remains under 100 millivolts. It is not perfect, but can be reduced with some additional capacitors later. But for now, the important thing is that it is totally pulsing. And after some minutes of running, the CPU is even barely warm. Now let's try the 3V AMD 486DX280 CPU. I'll not change the front side bus and will leave it at 33 MHz. And it posts, but says that it is a 486DX275. What is of course totally wrong, since at 33 MHz nothing should change compared to the previous DX266. I was expecting this, to be honest, but let's boot into DOS. Yeah, as you see, CPU identification says 100 MHz and not 66 MHz. Also in sysinfo, the CPU is detected as 100 MHz. Why is that happening? Well, compared to older DX versions, DX2 and DX4 CPUs had a new signal for the internal clock multiplier, which is a bit irritating. Earlier, DX2 versions had this signal on the pin B13, and the documentation said that it has to be pulled down to the ground to work properly. Later versions of these CPUs were prepared for the write-back cache support and used that pin for cache mode signaling. The clock multiplier was moved to pin R17, which was not connected on the previous CPUs. Well, this DX280 seems to be such a later version with swapped signals, and it is mistakenly overclocked to 100 MHz. The good news is it is totally stable, but unfortunately it looks like this board has no jumper options to set that combination properly. Or maybe I'm missing something. I guess I'll have to reverse engineer all the jumpers on this board to find out which one goes to which pin. But I think this is an interesting topic for an own video. And for now, I'll just move on to another CPU. But just in case, if you have a DX2 CPU which tries to run with a wrong clock multiplier, now you know why. Here I have an Intel DX4100 CPU. It is of course also a 3-volt CPU. It runs with 33 MHz front side bus and a multiplier 3. Basically, it is just as fast as the older clocked DX2 80 MHz, which I showed before, but without overclocking. I could use this one, but I have a second identical CPU, but with a heatsink glued on top. I borrowed this CPU from one of my retro setups, and I know that this CPU is very stable and runs at 120 MHz with 40 MHz front side bus. Let's see if we can get so far on this board. Well, for some reasons, the CPU is detected as P24C 75 MHz. Well, don't ask me why, but this board seems to throw out the names and the detected clock randomly. Well, at least in CPU identification utility, the CPU is detected properly as 100 MHz DX4 with 33 MHz frontside bus and a multiplier 3. Sysinfo shows a good value, it is almost as fast as a Pentium 66. Let's see what Doom says. (2715 real ticks), that is 27.5 FPS on an ISA VGA card. Not bad at all for a 486 DX4100. Compared to the numbers from my last video, this is again an increase by almost 1.5 FPS, and I'm pretty sure this is the fastest frame rate which I ever saw on a 486 DX4100 on an ISA VGA card. I'm still very impressed by this board, but can we get more out of it? Let me switch the jumpers to 40 MHz frontside bus to try to get to effective 120 MHz. As I previously said, I know that this CPU can run at that speed. Funny enough, at 120 MHz in another board, I'm getting lower scores than at 100 MHz already on this board. And it doesn't pause at all. Let me make a reset. Nope, no reaction at all. Okay, let's increase the CPU voltage a little bit. It is actually not good to set the voltage without a load on a switching regulator. But let's set it to 3.6 volts. No, still not pulsing. And look at the voltage, it dropped to 3 volts. That is too low. That's why I said that it is better to set up the voltage with a load. Okay, let's do that and try 3.3 volts again. Okay, something happens. I get a video signal and a cursor is blinking, but the system still doesn't post. Let's raise the voltage to 3.6 volts. This is still in specs for a DX4100 and see what happens. It seems to get further, but it hangs with annoying beep. Funny enough, the CPU is now detected as 100 MHz one, despite that it should be now at 120 MHz. Okay, let's get evil and get it to 4 volts. Okay, now it is not posting at all again. Well, I think I don't want to torture the system anymore, and for now I will bring the voltage back down to 3.3 volts and the CPU to 100 MHz. And it is booting again. The CPU is detected as 100 MHz. The level 1 cache throughput over 100 MB per second is not bad. Also, a level 2 cache and memory throughput are very good for a DX4100. As I said in the last part, this ALI chipset-based board delivers impressive performance. Well, this board is fast. It is stable at 33 MHz clock and supports now different CPU voltages. This is what makes this board absolutely mind-blowing. It is an amazing bridge technology. A very long bridge, which accepts 386 CPUs from 1985 to 486 DX4 and theoretically even AM5X86 CPUs from 1995. 10 years of development, 2 CPU architectures, 2 different memory SIM types, 2 interfaces for expansion cards, and an option for different CPU voltages. Incredible combination. And though it still has some secrets to reveal. First of all, why it doesn't deliver 80 MHz clock required for the 386 DX40. Second, what can be done to convince it to run with various clock multipliers? It obviously requires some reverse engineering. And last but not least, why didn't it want to work at 120 MHz? Maybe this is due to some voltage ripple from the switching voltage regulator, which could be fixed with some filtering. A lot of interesting questions, which I will maybe answer in the future. If you are interested to see more about this board, write into the comments. But for now, I'll put this exciting board aside and we'll get back to another very interesting project. If you watch my channel regularly, maybe you remember this. Well, I found some time to get back to it and I have some good news to share. Until then, don't forget to leave your feedback below and join me soon on my channel again. Thank you and goodbye.